Let's pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for a Bible study. Thank you for the journey mercies you granted everyone. Thank you for keeping us in perfect health so we can concentrate on the teaching of the Word of God tonight. Lord, we're praying the blessing of the Word will be upon every one of our lives in Jesus' name. Open our eyes to see our spiritual condition, and then open our eyes to see your grace and your provision at Calvary that will fulfill every need of our lives spiritually and in every way in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, you'll keep us awake as we study your word together tonight. And let the profit of reading and studying the word be visible and known in every life in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. I welcome you to the Bible study tonight. We're continuing with our series on in the book of 1 John, Epistle of 1 John. And we're looking at chapter 2 today from verse 3. The first epistle of John, chapter 2. Open your Bible with me as we read together. I'm reading from verse 3. And hereby we do know that we know him if we keep his commandments. He that says, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoso keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we know that we are in him. He that says he abideth in him ought himself also so to walk, even as he walked. Brethren, I write no new commandment unto you, but an old commandment which ye had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which ye have heard from the beginning. Again, a new commandment I write unto you, which thing is true in him and in you, because the darkness is past and the true light now shineth. He that says he is in the light and hateth his brother is in darkness even until now. He that loveth his brother abideth in the light, and there is none occasion of stumbling in him. Verse 11, but he that hateth his brother is in darkness and walketh in darkness and knoweth not whither he goeth, because that darkness has blinded his eyes. Those are the verses we're looking at today. We're reading and studying together. I've titled this study tonight, The Certainty of an Indispensable Salvation Experience. Actually, as you look at 1 John, 1 John tells us about eternal life, about knowing the Lord, about loving the Lord, about walking after the Lord and walking in the light. The Apostle John was very much concerned about the profession of many people, because he found out there were many people that claimed to be saved. They claimed to have eternal life. They claimed to know the Lord. They claimed they were following the Lord. And yet the claim was shallow. The claim was superficial. And the claim could not be verified by the lives they lived. They said they claimed they knew God. They claimed they believed in the Lord. And they claimed that they were abiding in Christ. And yet, they were not truthful and trustworthy. Their profession was not supported by their lifestyle. It was not a totally new situation. It was like that in the Old Testament. It was like that during the time of the Lord Jesus Christ in the Gospels. And then at the time of the apostles, it was like that too. That there were many people that had profession of faith, profession of religion, and profession of following after the Lord. They professed that they knew Christ. They professed that they were saved. And yet, they could not prove that by the life they lived. That's why you'll find that John keeps on saying, if anyone says he knows the Lord, if anyone says he's in the light, and yet he's walking in darkness, he's lying and deceiving himself. Look at chapter 1. In chapter 1, I'm reading here from verse 5. If we say we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we'll lie and do not the truth. Obviously, there were people saying, yes, we're walking in the light. Yes, we know Christ. Yes, we are born again. Yes, we have salvation. Yes, we have eternal life. And Paul and the apostle said, but your life does not reflect that. Your life does not show that. Your life does not prove that. Look at chapter 2. In chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 4. He that says, I know him and keepeth not his commandment is a liar, and the truth is not in him. He's still emphasizing the same thing. Profession without the life that will follow that, that will back that up. Look at verse 9. He that says he is in the light and hateth his brother is in darkness even until now. He keeps on saying, he that says, I'm giving testimony. I have a profession. I know the Lord. I know what eternal life is all about. And he says, but prove it by the life you live. Look at verse 11. It says again, but he that hateth his brother is in darkness and walketh in darkness and knoweth not whither he goeth, because the darkness has blinded his eyes. As I said, this was not a totally new situation to people who read the Bible, those who know the Bible. There have always been people that will say, yes, we know the Lord. Yes, we are following the Lord. Yes, we are righteous. And yet their lives did not prove what he said. In 2 Kings chapter 17, 2 Kings chapter 17, I'm reading from verse 33. The same set of people, the same kind of people. We know the Lord. We believe the Lord. We are following the Lord. We are on our way to heaven. We have eternal life. And we are related with the Lord. And yet their lives was not corroborating or proving what they said. 2 Kings chapter 17 verse 33. They feared the Lord and served their own gods. You can see there in the first line it says they feared the Lord. If you had stopped there, you said, those who are believers, those who are people that are following after the Lord. But then it said, and they served their own gods after the manner of the nations whom they had carried away captive. Look at verse 34. Unto this day, they do after their former manners. And the conclusion is, they fear not the Lord. They do after their former manners, after their previous character, after their idolatrous practices. And then the conclusion is, they feared not the Lord. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 29. And then you'll find that at the time of the kings, it was like that. At the time of the prophets too, it was like that. Claiming, we know the Lord, we love the Lord, we believe the Lord, we are following the Lord, we are righteous, we are the kingdom of God. And yet their lives did not prove what he was saying. Isaiah chapter 29, reading here from verse 13. Wherefore the Lord said, for as much as these people drew near me with their mouth and with their lips, they do honor me, but have removed their heart far from me, and their fear toward me is taught by the precept of men, taught by the tradition of men, taught by the practices of men. It says, therefore, behold, I will proceed to do a marvelous work among these people, even a marvelous work and a wonder, for the wisdom of their wise men shall perish, and the understanding of their prudent shall be hid. In verse 15, woe unto them that seek to hide, deep to hide their counsel from the Lord, and their works are in the dark. And they say, who seeth us and who knoweth us? So you can tell that those people had the same kind of profession. Yes, we know the Lord. Yes, we are following after the Lord. And yet it says they were not really following after the will of the Lord, and they were not obeying the word of God. They couldn't prove by the life they lived that they really knew the Lord experientially. As we have read in Isaiah, so we have in Ezekiel chapter 33. The Lord here talking to Ezekiel and said, don't mistake the people coming and people asking, well, want to know the word of God, want to know the will of God. Don't mistake that for being genuine. Don't mistake that for being serious and being dependable and trustworthy. They hear, but they will not do. They profess, but they cannot prove it. Their lives do not show that they actually were following after the Lord. Ezekiel 33 verse 31. Ezekiel 33, verse 31. And they come unto thee as the people cometh, and the siege before thee as my people. That is, as if they were my people, as if they were obedient people, as if they were saved people, as if they were holy and sanctified, as if they were going to heaven. They sit before you as my people, and they hear thy words, but they will not do them, for their mouths, for with their mouth they show much love, but their heart goeth after their covetousness. Again, you'll see there that there were people that professed they knew the Lord, but in reality, they didn't know the Lord. Their lives did not show. We're looking at all this so that you'll see the concern of John the Beloved. He was concerned that there were people that will say, yes, we know the Lord, yes, we love the Lord, yes, we are following the Lord, and yet their lives was to the contrary. And there are people like that today too. Maybe if you examine your life, you might discover that your profession is loud, your testimony is loud. I know the Lord. I knew the Lord since 19 such and such, or 2000 and such, but your life does not show, does not prove the testimony you are giving. And the Lord wants us to match our testimony with our profession. We're looking at John. At the time of the Lord Jesus Christ, see how the people reacted, how they responded to the words of the Lord, and to the wonders of the Lord, and to the signs that they performed, and to those miracles that they had performed. And you will think that those were real believers, but Jesus said, no, they were not, in John chapter 2. John chapter 2, reading from verse 23. Now, when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover, in the feast day, many believed in his name. Isn't that what we're supposed to do? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. I raise up my hand. I believe. I'm following the Lord. And I've even been baptized in water. Believe. I believe. Well, does that mean everybody that says, I believe, everybody is going to heaven? Look at this. Look at the latter part now. It says they believed. Many believed in his name when they saw the miracles which he did. But Jesus did not commit himself unto them, because he knew all men, and needed not that any man should testify of man, for he knew what was in man. He knew the hearts of the people, the spirit of the people. He knew the imaginations of the people. He knew the secret lives of the people. Therefore, he couldn't trust them, and he couldn't give himself unto them, because he knew all men. Their testimonies were superficial. Their profession was superficial. It wasn't for real. They didn't have genuine experience and genuine salvation of the Lord. There are many people like that today. They go to churches, evangelical churches, Pentecostal churches, and they go to all kinds of churches, even go to deeper life. And yet, when you look at their lives, you cannot tell. There is no evidence that you really know the Lord. There's no evidence that the word is working in them. In John chapter 6, John chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 24. When the people therefore saw that Jesus was not there, neither his disciples, they also took shipping and came to Capernaum seeking for Jesus. Isn't that somebody interested in the Lord? Are these not people wanting to know the way to heaven? Are these not the people wanting to walk the narrow way that leads to heaven? Not really. The Lord will tell you now. Look at verse 25. And when they had found him on the other side of the sea, they said unto him, Rabbi, teacher, master, when camest thou hither? And Jesus answered and said, verily, verily, I say unto you, ye seek me not before, because ye saw the miracles, but because ye did eat of the loaves and were filled. They were interested in the physical blessing, in the bread and butter, in the miracle that will supply their needs. But the change of life, the transformation of life, the conversion of their soul, the salvation that will make sure that they are born again and they will lead them to heaven, all that they were not interested in. There are many people like that today. They go to these camps and conferences and conventions, and they go to all these churches, and they come to our programs too, and you know, weekend meeting, they're always there because I'm going to get this, I'm going to get that. How about repentance? How about getting saved? How about salvation in Christ? How about preparing for heaven? How about preparing for eternity? All that they are not interested in. And look at what Jesus said in verse 27. Labor not for that meat which perisheth, but for that meat which endureth unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you. For him has God the Father sealed. And then he began to ask questions. Okay, what are we going to do? Tell us now. The standard of the word of God. Tell us what you expect us to do so that we'll follow after you. And then we'll be for real. Our profession will join with our practice. We'll join with our, we'll prove our lifestyle. Or will prove our experience. And then Jesus began to tell them the demands of the kingdom and what they will have to believe, what they have to turn away from, and what they have to turn to. Look at verse 60 here. Many therefore of his disciples, the people that were running after him, oh Lord, we've been seeking for you, we've been searching, and we came over here, we discovered you here now. When did you come to this side? These people, many of them, many therefore of his disciples, when they heard this, said, this is an hard saying. Who can bear it and who can hear it? Repentance. This is an hard saying. Who can hear this? Leaving religion and coming to Christ the Redeemer. This is an hard saying. Who can hear this one? Who can bear this one? Believing on the Lord Jesus Christ and receiving him in all totality and entirety. This is an hard saying. Who can receive this? And turning away from you all your iniquity, all your sin, all your transgression, everything you'll be used to, which is of the devil, which is of depravity, which is of the old life. Turn away from everything and come to the Lord and come into a new life that will get you to heaven eventually through the grace of God. It is an hard saying. Who can bear it? Who can hear it? Look at verse 66. From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. You will think then that Jesus Christ will change the standard. Oh no, he couldn't change the standard because there's only one way that leads to heaven. He couldn't change the standard because it is a narrow way that leads to life eternal. And that's what many people expect us to do today. After you have preached the word of God and you say, this is the way, walk ye therein. And then you begin to talk to each other. I had this before and I thought that we've changed already. I thought that we're going to lower the standard. I thought we're going to modify what we're saying, make it easy for us to be in the church. Well, we can make it easy for you to be in the church, but you won't get to heaven. Getting to heaven is more than just being in the church. And some people will say, you see, the pastor does not remember. Many years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, you know, he preached like this. And then some people, they left. That's the other side happened in the ministry of Jesus Christ. And Jesus now addressed the other people with him and said, will you also go away? Because the standard will not change. The way to life eternal will not change. The way of eternal life will not change. And the way of salvation and the holiness without which no man shall see the Lord, it will not change. And so Jesus said, will you also go away? Look at this in verse 67. Then said Jesus unto the 12, will ye also go away? Then Simon Peter answered, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. We're going to stay with the word. And we're going to stay until we get to heaven in Jesus' name. Look at Titus chapter 1. Titus chapter 1. I'm just showing you all over the Bible, Old Testament and New Testament, from the kings and the prophets, and then the gospels and the epistles too. That it was always like that. People professing that they know the Lord, and yet their lives contradicting the word. And then you check up your life. Are you like that too? Professing that you know the Lord, and you are hearing the word over and over. You'll not say you've not heard about salvation. If you've been coming here for some time, about sanctification, holiness, if you've been coming for some, maybe you are even giving testimony. Praise the Lord, I'm saved. Praise the Lord, I'm sanctified. And praise the Lord, I love the Lord. Praise the Lord, this is my church. I accept the word of God. Don't talk too much. Let's look at your life. Let your life tell us the story. Let your living tell us the story. Let your behavior tell us the story. Too much profession, but no proof of that profession. Titus chapter 1, we're looking at verse 16. It says, they profess that they know God, but in works they deny him. In behavior they deny him. In action they deny him. In their relationships they deny him. In their character they deny him. In their conduct they deny him. It says they profess that they know God, but in words they deny him, being abominable. Can you imagine that, church people? Abominable and disobedient and unto every good work reprobate. That's why John the beloved wants everyone to be sure that we must have a definite experience of salvation, because without a definite experience of salvation, all profession of knowing God, believing Christ and loving Christ and following Christ, all profession of worshiping and serving and honoring God will be of no value, will be in vain. There will be an irreversible state of suffering and sorrow in eternity for such people. And that's why the apostle wants everybody to ascertain, everybody to know and be very sure that we are truly saved and that we have eternal life. Do you know beyond any shadow of doubt that you are saved? Let's find out. Come back to 1 John. In 1 John chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 3. 1 John chapter 2, verse 3. And you'll see how many times John is making use of the word know. We know. We know. And you ought to know. You ought to check up your experience and know. Are you really in the faith? Are you really in the Lord? Are you on your way to heaven? It tells us in 1 John chapter 2, verse 3. It says, hereby do we know. That's the word again there. Hereby do we know that we know him if we keep his commandment. It says, that's the mark. It says, that's the measure. It says, that's the manifestation. If you're going to say, yes, I know the Lord, it says, hereby do we know that we know him if we keep his commandments. Look at verse 5. But whoso keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we, that's the word again, hereby know we that we are in him. Look at verse 29 of that same chapter 2. In verse 29, if ye know that he is righteous, ye know that everyone that doeth righteousness is born of him. You see that word know again? He just wants you to be very sure. He doesn't want you to take it for granted. I think I'm born again. Not I think, I know. I think I should be born again by now because I've been coming for some time. Not I think, I know. Do you really know beyond any shadow of doubt that you're a real child of God? He says, and if we know that he is righteous, we know that everyone that doeth righteousness is born of him. Look at chapter 3, verse 14. Chapter 3, verse 14, we know. Here is it again. We know that we are passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. He said, I can give you the reason why we know. It's not just because I saw Christ performing miracles, I was healed, and I saw Jesus Christ multiplying bread, and I was part of the people that distributed that, and I saw him turning water into wine, and that was a wonderful time. He said, no. The reason why we know we have eternal life, the reason why we know we belong to the Lord, we know that we have passed from death unto life. Because, this is the reason why, because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. He may shout about salvation, I'm saved. He may shout about sanctification, I am sanctified. He may shout about being to the mount of transfiguration, I am this, I am that. If he does not love the brethren, he abideth in death. Look at verse 24 of that same chapter 3. In verse 24 it says, and he that keepeth his commandment dwelleth in him, and he in him. Hereby we know that he abideth in us. It says, you keep his commandments, you have the grace, you have the strength, you have the power, you have the desire, you have the liking, and you have the love to keep the commandments of God. And every time your own desire is, I must keep his commandment, I love his commandment, and I must walk in the way of his commandment. He said, that's how we know that you're a real child of God. Anything from that is self-delusion and self-deception. Look at chapter 4, verse 6. In chapter 4, verse 6, It says, we are of God, and he that knoweth God heareth us. We are of God. He said, we are apostles, we are of God. He gave us the word of salvation. He gave us the word of holiness. He gave us the word of truth. And he gave us a spirit, the spirit of truth. And we know that everyone that knows God heareth us. He wants to come and hear us, because Jesus said, he that heareth you heareth me. He that heareth you not does not hear me and does not know me. He who does not accept you does not accept me. And so John said, we are of God, and he that knoweth God heareth us. Do you delight in hearing the word of God, or do you spurn the word of God? Do you scorn the word of God? Do you throw away the word of God somewhere and say, I'm not interested in that. All I'm interested in is only miracle, miracle. Then you don't know God. Then you are not born again. You are not a child of God. We know that we have God. And he that knoweth God heareth us. Look at verse 7 there. In verse 7 it says, beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. And knoweth God. You see how he repeats the word knowing, knowing every time. It says, you can tell by your life. You can tell by the practical life you live that you know him, you love him. Look at verse 8. He that loveth not knoweth not God. He that loveth not knoweth not God. There's animosity there, there's bitterness there, there's hatred there, and there's fighting there, and there's conflicting there in your heart. It says, don't deceive yourself. All that profession of, you know, I saw Jesus, I dreamt, and he said, your sins are forgiven, and somebody told me that you are born again, somebody told me you are saved. He said, all that is subjective. We cannot prove that one. The one we can prove is this. Look at verse 8. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. Look at chapter 5, verse 2. In chapter 5, verse 2, he's still telling us the same thing. How do we know that we know God? And how do we know that our experiences are for real, genuine salvation? Chapter 5, verse 2. It says, by this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and keep his commandments. That's it. That's it. That's what he repeats every time. The power to obey and the grace to obey and the grace to follow the Lord all the time and follow the word of God. He said, that is the proof that you really know God. Look at verse 13. In verse 13 of that chapter 5, he's telling us again about knowing God. He says, these things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know, that ye may know, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. Look at verse 18. We know. Can you see? You cannot go through the epistle, this first epistle of John, without coming to a certainty of your indispensable experience of salvation. You'll either know I have it or I don't have it. And if you don't have it, John will show you that this is the way to have it. And I pray that every one of us will be in possession of this wonderful experience in Jesus' name. Are you still there? I say, we'll be in possession in Jesus' name. Look at verse 18. It says, we know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not. He said, this one we know. This one we know. He says, don't mind all those people that give all those big, big testimonies and great testimonies, loud testimonies, and then we find them living in sin. We find them living in some secret sin or besetting sin. They don't have the victory. But here it says, we know that whosoever, whoever it may be, high or low, we know that whosoever, young or maybe elderly, whosoever, a man, a woman, whosoever, married or not married, whosoever, a teenager, a young person or an older person, we know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not. But he that is begotten of God keepeth himself, and that wicked one toucheth him not. I pray that this assurance the Lord will give unto every one of us in Jesus' name. The certainty of an indispensable salvation experience. We're dividing the study to three parts. Number one, experiential proof of salvation in Christ. The experiential proof of salvation in Christ. That means this one is not theoretical. This one is just, it's not a notion. This one is just, it's not a doctrine written on paper alone. This one is an experience. This one is what we can see in your life. It's a tangible thing. It's a touchable thing. And it's an evident thing. Experiential proof of salvation in Christ. Number two, empty profession of salvation without Christ-likeness. Empty profession. A profession that will not hold water. Profession that will not take anybody to heaven. Profession that doesn't go beyond the world here. Empty. No value. Worthless. Empty profession of salvation without Christ-likeness. Number three is essential precept for saints in Christ. Essential precept for saints in Christ. We're coming to number one. Number one, experiential proof of salvation in Christ. What's the proof that we have salvation in Christ? Let's come back to this 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2, and we're reading from verse 3 all through to verse 6. It says in verse 3, and hereby do we know that we know him if we keep his commandments. He said there's no complication here. There's no difficulty here. And you don't need to understand the original languages here. And you don't need to go to, you know, higher institution before you can understand this. These are simple words. Hereby do we know that we know him if we keep his commandments. Very straight, much, very much straightforward. In verse 4 it says, and he that says, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whosoever, whoso keepeth his word, in him verily, whosoever he may be in our church, may be in another church, may be a person that had it from Paul, or had it from Peter, or had the gospel from John, whoever you had it from, whosoever, he tells us here, keeps his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are him. Look at verse 6. He that says, he abideth in him, ought himself also so to walk, even as he walked. Here you can tell what the apostle is saying. On the one hand, he says, he that says, he that says. Then on the other hand, he says, he that keepeth. On the one hand, he that saith, what's that? That's profession. He that keepeth, what's that? That's the proof. That's the proof that his profession is actually right. Come back to this in chapter 2, verse 4. And see that three times over here in chapter 2, he says, he that saith, he that saith, he that saith. Look at verse 4. Chapter 1, chapter 2 rather, and we're looking at verse 4. It says, he that saith, I know him. Look at verse 6. He that saith, he abideth in him. Look at verse 9. In verse 9, he that says, he is in the light. That's profession. Saying, saying, saying. But now he comes back and he says, can I tell you how we can test your profession? How we can ascertain your profession? How we can tell whether your profession is right or wrong, whether it is true or it is false? He says, he that keepeth, he that keepeth, he that keepeth. Look at this in chapter 2, and I'm reading here from chapter 2 verse 5. And whoso keepeth his word, he says, that's how we know. Whoso keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him. Then look at chapter 3, verse 24. In chapter 3, verse 24, telling us we're looking for he that keepeth, keeping the commandments of the Lord. It tells us in verse 24, chapter 3, he that keepeth his commandments dwelleth in him. It says, that's how we know. He that keepeth his commandment dwelleth in him. Look at chapter 5, verse 3. It says, and for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not grievous. So then, how do we know that we have this experiential proof of salvation in Christ? It says, he that keepeth his commandments. It tells us on one hand, we know him. On the other hand, it says, we keep his commandments. We know him. It says, okay, that's enough. That's enough testimony. That's enough profession. Prove it now. We keep his commandments. Look at this in chapter 2 and verse 3. Hereby know we that we know him. We know him. That's the phrase there. If we keep his commandments, immediately it follows by saying, we know him. How? Because we keep his commandments. Look at chapter 2 and verse 4. Chapter 2 verse 4, he that says, I know him, and keepeth not his commandment, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. He says it the other way again. We know him, we keep his commandments. Somebody says, I know him, but he doesn't keep the commandments of God. He said, it's a liar. Look at verse 5. Whoso keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we know him. He says it in different ways, but he lands on the same conclusion. We know him because of that. We keep his commandments. Chapter 3, verse 22. In chapter 3, verse 22, talking about those who say they know God, chapter 3, we're looking at verse 22. Verse 22, and whatsoever we ask, we receive of him because we keep his commandments. Because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. Do you love the commandments of God? Or you only look for, you know, the promises of God and the good things the Lord will do and the signs and the wonders and the miracles? Do you have the responsibility responding to the word of God? And you have the inner drive and the inner desire. I love the commandments of God. I appreciate the commandments of God. I want to learn more about the commandments of God. I want to receive more about the commandments of God. And it's the commandment that really turns me on. I love him so much. I know him. I belong to him. And because of that, I want to keep his commandments. And that's the desire of the person that really wants to follow after the Lord. Look at verse 24 here. In verse 24, chapter 3, and he that keepeth his commandments dwelleth in him. He dwells in him. He loves him. He's related to him because he keeps the commandment of the Lord. As we talk about the commandment of the Lord, I hope you understand that Jesus Christ gave a lot of commandments. For example, he says, repent and believe the gospel. Be repent and believe ye the gospel. That's the commandment of Christ. And if somebody does not obey that commandment and just follow after religion, it doesn't pay and it doesn't work. The Lord Jesus Christ said, be converted and become like a little child, and ye must be born again, is the commandment of the Lord. He said, if you are not born again, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. He says, stop everything and stop all that religion and be born again. That's the commandment of the Lord. And the people that really want to know the Lord and follow after the Lord, is, I know his commandment, I know his commandment. He said, repent, I have to repent. He said, ye must be born again, I must be born again. He said, go and sin no more. He said, I'm forgiving you now. I'm erasing your past. I'm taking away all the sins you committed in the past. Neither do I condemn you for the past, but now go in the future and sin no more. That's the commandment of Christ. And the person who doesn't take that commandment seriously and is still falling into sin every day and every week and doing evil and then smoking all the sin and drinking all the sin and touching all the sin and partaking all the sin, that's not a disciple of Christ. That's not a follower of Christ. He says we know him. How do we know that we know him? Because we keep his commandments. What's the commandment of Christ? Go and sin no more. You remember the commandment of the Lord, continue ye in my word. By this shall I know that you are my disciple indeed, if you continue in my word. And he gave us the commandment, here is my word, here is my doctrine, here is my teaching. Continue in that word. And he says, that's how we know that you take God serious. That's how we know that you take Christian life serious, because you continue in his word. You remember he said, beware of false prophets. Beware of false prophet. It says, even if you're sick, beware of false prophet. You're looking, you want to get admission to a higher institution, and then you're looking for prayer houses. Beware of false prophet. You want a provision, you want this, you want that. It says, beware of false prophets. It's a commandment. And because he gave you that commandment and said, beware, are you obeying that commandment? Are you taking heed to your way? Then he said, beware of covetousness, the love of money, which is the root of all evil. Beware. Are you taking note of that? Or is it, you know, church, church, church? We go to church, we come to church, and the commandments of God we're not taking heed to. Then he said, you must also beware of all these people that are running up and down. They want to sell this to you and give you this one and give you that. He said, beware. And if you're a real child of God, you're going to take that to heart. He said, do unto others as you want them to do unto you. You see that? That's the commandment of the Lord. And so if you're just walking around and you're just religious and reading Bible and doing this and this up and down, all the things that the people do, and then the way you act and the way you live and the way you conduct your life, you never remember what Jesus said, the commandment of the Lord, that you will do unto other people as you want them to do unto you. That's not Christianity. That's not faith in Christ. That's not salvation. How do we know we have salvation? By remembering the commandments of the Lord, and then we follow after those commandments and we're obedient to that. Do you remember we read that this last month, January, at the covenant service, that you seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. He said, concentrate on that kingdom and concentrate on the glory of God. You want to bring glory to God, you want that to be the number one thing in your life. It says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. It's a commandment of Christ. And if you say, I love the Lord, Christ will be number one in your life. His kingdom will be number one in your life. Obedience to the word will be number one in your life. And following after him at all times, in all ways, and every way possible by the grace of God, that will be number one in your life. He said, love everyone else. Love your brother, love your sister as I have loved you. A new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Now, if you are not doing that and just following this and that, you see, Christianity is that you see the word of the Lord, you see the commandments of Christ, and then you follow after. And as you listen to all this, would you say that you're a real believer? Are the commandments of Christ important to you? Or is it just religion? Do you know that you are really saved? Do you know you are born again? Do you have the grace of God on the inside of you? Are you obeying the word of God from the heart? This is what the Lord expects, and I pray that he reproduce that in every life in Jesus' name. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I'm reading here from verse 17. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And we're looking at verse 17, the evidence of salvation in Christ, the proof of salvation in Christ, that will say, praise the Lord, I know I'm saved. My life has turned around. My life is changed. I'm not what I used to be. The grace of God is in me, and I love and I cherish and I appreciate the commandments of God. And just that's what I want to live on, and that's what I want to do. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. It says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Times of rebellion, that's passed away. Of sinning, that's passed away. Of yielding to temptation, that's passed away. Of just following after the crowd, all that is passed away. Of eating and drinking, all their festival things, all that is passed away. Of the work of darkness, all that is passed away. Of all the conduct that they do in the nightclubs, all that is passed away. Because therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. And behold, tell me the rest over here. All things have become new. Language new, dressing new, appearance new, and everything you do, everything has become new now, because the grace of God is there. And I pray that that grace will be multiplied in every one of our lives in Jesus' name. And so, the proof that we're real children of God, the proof that we have the salvation of the Lord, is that we keep his commandments. And day and night and every time, what's important to us is that commandment of the Lord. Let's come to point number two now. Empty profession of salvation without Christ-likeness. Empty profession of salvation without Christ-likeness. Now, if you ask people generally, how do you know you are born again? How do you know you are a child of God? And then they'll tell you, for this reason, for that reason, I was born in a Christian home. That's not enough. Ye must be born again. The salvation we're talking about, and the salvation that takes us to heaven, is a personal experience. It's something that you will know for sure that I am born born again. I am a child of God. This is not just religion. We're talking about you knowing the Lord in a very definite way, personal way, and a way that can be evidential, can be proved, that people can know from your life that truly you're born again. Let's see these people that have the empty profession, worthless profession, and a shallow profession. The profession that is not truthful and not trustworthy, and yet they're saying that they are born again, they are born again. Let's come to 1 John chapter 2, and we're reading from verse 4. 1 John chapter 2, I'm reading verse 4 here. It says, he that says, I know him. You see how he talks in such an affirmative way. I know him, and yet keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. He is a liar, and the truth is not in him. And let's look at verse 9. In verse 9, he's still telling us about these people that have the empty profession of salvation without Christ likeness. In verse 9, he that says he is in the light, categorical. He that says he is in the light, affirmative and positive, and hateth his brother, is in darkness even until now. He says, if he hates his brother, he's still in darkness until now. Look at verse 11. In verse 11, but he that hateth his brother is in darkness, and walketh in darkness, and knoweth not whither he goeth, because the darkness has blinded his eyes. Is in darkness and knoweth not whither he goeth. What does that mean? He does not know he's going to hell. He thinks he's going to heaven. He does not know he's going to have darkness forever and ever. And he's saying, I'm on my way to glory land, because he doesn't know. And the hatred is there. The bitterness is there in his heart. And with all that bitterness, and with all that malice, and with all that quarrel, and with all the conflict and the evil sin in his heart, he says, I'm still on my way to heaven. There are three things here. Number one, holiness experienced. Holiness experienced. Number two, hypocrisy exposed. Hypocrisy exposed. And number three, hatred explained. And he says, you need to look at all this, and then you'll be able to measure all the profession you are trying to make. Number one, holiness experience. Let's come back to this. Chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 4. He that says, I know him, and keepeth not his commandment, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoso keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we know him. Holiness experience. Look at verse 6. He that saith he abideth in him, ought himself also so to walk, even as he walked. He said, here is the evidence you are born again. Here is the evidence you have a Savior. Here is the evidence you love the Savior and you are following after the Savior. He that says he abideth in him, ought himself also so to walk, even as he walked. Look at 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21. 1 Peter chapter 2, reading from verse 21. It says in verse 21, for even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow, that he should follow his steps. That he should follow his steps. That is holiness experience. He lives in your heart. You love him. It's like you're attracted to him. Every time you're asking yourself, if Christ Jesus, my Lord, my Savior, were in this situation, how will he respond to this? How will he react to this? What will he do about this? If Jesus Christ was confronted by a tempter, by a temptress, what will Jesus do? He will live the overcoming life. If Jesus Christ was confronted by the people of the world to follow after them, what will Jesus do? He will resist all those actions of the people of the world. If anybody in the world wanted Jesus Christ to follow after them and turn away from the Heavenly Father, what will Jesus do? He will live to please the Father. And so he says, if you say you abide in him, ye ought also to walk even as Christ walked. Holiness explained. That means holiness is simply the life of Christ in you by his grace. He was humble, so you are humble. He was obedient to the Father, so you are obedient. He was loving, so you will be loving. He was innocent, innocent of evil. He will not do evil, so you will not do anything of evil. He endured to the very end, and so you will be walking with the Lord, enduring to the very end. He was separated from all the things of this world, and so you will be separated also. He was totally submissive to the Heavenly Father, and you are submissive to the Heavenly Father. You are looking at Jesus Christ, at the life of Jesus Christ, and there is a desire inside your heart. Holiness experience, you've experienced that, and then that makes you to want to follow after the Lord. Look at 1 John 3:3. 1 John 3, and we're reading from verse 3. It says, and every man that has this hope in him purifies himself even as he is pure. He's not looking at other people to give excuse. I know that brother so-and-so is also doing this. That's an excuse. It's not your model. Christ is your model. I know that, you know, brother so-and-so is also quarrels with his wife. And, you know, sometimes I settle quarrels for them too. That's not your model. That's not your standard. Christ is your standard. I know that, you know, sometimes when they tell us to do this and we read it from the word of God, I know sister so-and-so still has her own way. And she still follows what she wants to do. She's not your model. If you are born again, if you are a child of God, you're looking unto Christ. You're looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross and despised the shame. Whatever people say, their ridicule, their insult, their assault will not matter to you. I want to follow Christ. And every man that has this hope in him purifies himself even as he is pure. Colossians 2, I'm reading from verse 6. Colossians 2, and we're looking at verse 6. And so if you're really born again, here is the evidence. You're looking away from all those people who are falling and rising, all those people who are living in sin and giving excuse, all those people who are rejoicing in iniquity, and they commit their own sin, they rebel against the word of God publicly, and then they say, you see how bold I am. Yes, I can say how bold you are. You are bold for hell. You are bold for eternal judgment and eternal perdition. But you see, the people who are going to heaven, they are not bold to do evil. They are not bold to commit sin. They are not bold to be rebellious. They are only bold to oppose Satan. They are bold to resist the devil. They are bold to resist temptation. They are bold to say no to the devil. You know, the one that is saying yes to the devil and no to God and no to the word of God, that's not boldness. That's the kind of boldness that will take you to hellfire. But the people who are bold for righteousness, and they are bold for truth, and they are bold for this sound doctrine, and they have the grace of God in them, and they say, Satan, you can turn on the heat, and you can increase the temptation and the trial. I'm going to say no to you because I say yes to the Almighty God. That's real boldness. Look at Colossians 2, and I'm reading here from verse 6. Colossians 2:6. As ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him. You see that? As ye have also received Jesus Christ the Lord, so walk ye in him. That is holiness experience. Now come back to 1 John 2. 1 John 2, I'm reading from verse 4. It says, he that says, I know him and keepeth not his commandments is a liar. This is a hypocrite now. All the time saying, oh, don't worry about me, I'm born again. Don't worry about me, I'm a child of God. Hi about this, don't worry about that. I know, I said I know the Lord. You know, when I read the Bible, when I have my quiet time, and the Lord visits me, and the Holy Spirit ministers unto me, and then when I sing, and when I do this, I'm telling you, I'm like in the third heavens, and yet, okay, hi about this other one, hi about this, you know, shortcoming, hi about this adultery, hi about this fornication, don't touch that area. I just know I'm a child of God. My friend, you're a hypocrite. Hypocrisy explained, or hypocrisy exposed. Look at this in verse 4 again. He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, a liar, and the truth is not in him. Look at Job chapter 13. Job chapter 13, I'm reading here from verse 16. If you're a hypocrite, hypocrites will not get to heaven. And Jesus denounced them. Woe unto you, hypocrites. And then he explained what they were doing that made him to say they were hypocrites. If you're going to get to heaven, hypocrisy will vanish away from your life, will be cleansed away from your life, totally, completely, because the hypocrites will not see the face of the Lord. In Job chapter 13, verse 16, here is what it says. He also shall be my salvation, for an hypocrite shall not come before him. An hypocrite shall not come before him. When eventually the trumpet shall sound, when eventually the gates of heaven shall open, when eventually the saints shall go marching in, the hypocrites will not be allowed to go before the Lord Almighty. Look at Matthew chapter 23. Matthew chapter 23, we're looking at verse 28. Matthew chapter 23, and we're reading from verse 28. Hypocrisy exposed. Here the Lord Jesus Christ said in verse 28, he says, even so, ye also outwardly appear righteous unto men, but within ye are full of hypocrisy and iniquity. Full of hypocrisy and iniquity. Full of hypocrisy and iniquity. Inside their hearts, there is pretense. Inside their heart, real holiness is not there. Inside their heart, transparent life of living to the glory of God is not there. Hypocrisy, they just cover up, they cover up. They're reading that bad thing, somebody is coming, they quickly cover it up. Who are you deceiving? Are you living your life because of them, because of him, because of her? Are you not living your life because you want to get to heaven? Why don't you come straight to the Lord and say, Lord, from today, I want to live a transparent life, a life we can see through, a life that is hiding nothing in my heart, in my soul, in my mind, in my conduct and character. I want to live a life that glorifies the Lord. Hypocrisy exposed. I'm looking at Luke chapter 12. I'm reading from verse 1. Luke chapter 12, we're reading from verse 1. And here Jesus Christ warned his own disciples against hypocrisy. He tells us in chapter 12 of Luke verse 1, in the meantime, when there were gathered together an innumerable multitude of people, in so much that they trod upon one another, he began to say to his disciples, first of all, beware ye of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. Beware of the leaven, which is hypocrisy. Come back to 1 John chapter 2. I'm reading from verses 9 and 11. 1 John chapter 2, verses 9 and 11. This is the third part here now. Hatred explained. Number one, holiness experienced. Number two, hypocrisy exposed. And then number three now is hatred explained. We're looking at 1 John chapter 3 verse 9. In 1 John chapter 2, rather, chapter 2 verse 9, he that says he is in the light and hateth his brother. You see that? And hateth his brother. And hateth his brother. He is in darkness even until now. He hateth his brother. Why does he hate his brother? Something happened 50 years ago. Something happened 20 years ago. Something happened 5 years ago. Something happened last year. It brought a disagreement. And we've looked at that. We've resolved that. We've discussed that. And we've said, okay, forgive me. I'm sorry about that. Okay, I forgive. And yet, after he said, I've forgiven, since 15 years, since 20 years, and since 5 years, the thing is still turning in the heart. And every time if he wants to do something, he remembers 15 years ago. He remembers 20 years ago. And then he's doing this not because we offended him today, but because of what happened 5 years ago. Not because we, you know, said anything today that we shouldn't have said, but something happened last year. And because of that thing, he's still there. And he's still having that in the heart. He's pregnant with hatred. Pregnant is more than 9 months. It's more than 1 year. And he has not delivered. And he has not killed that thing. and he has not destroyed that thing, and he's still acting because of that. You can see it on his face. You can see it in his action. You can see it in his behavior. You can see it in his disposition. And even when you have not offended him today, he's still carrying nothing. And the word of God says, those who are like that, eternal life is far away from them. Look at this now. In 1 John chapter 3, 1 John chapter 3, and I'm reading here from verse 15. It says, whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer. Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer. And ye know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. It says you need to know this. If you're not going to just worship the Lord in vain, if you're not going to come to church in vain, if you're not going to serve in vain, it says, look at this. Whosoever hateth. Hated, that's in the present tense. Something happened before, but you carry the consequence of that. You carry the reaction to that. You carry it till today. And you sleep with it every time. And if the diary is in your brain, the diary is in your mind, the diary is in your heart, and you always remember, you even remember the year, you even remember the date. That's what he said, that's what he did, that's how he acted, and this and that. And the hatred is fresh, even though the offense is no more fresh, long, long ago. It says, whosoever hateth his brother, why don't we break it down? Whosoever hateth his wife, whosoever hateth her husband, whosoever hateth the parents. The parents have gone. What they did 50 years ago, you still remember today. And every time you remember, you're shivering with anger. As if I should see them now and show them. Because that time when they did that thing to me, I was weak, I was a little child, but now that I'm strong, now that I have a backbone, now that I can see them face to face and talk to them, I wish I could see that papa now. I wish I could see that mama now and just talk to him and talk to her straight like this, because I was not able to fight at this time, but now I'm strong to fight. But you'll not get to heaven if you die in that condition. Because you have hatred in your heart. He that hateth his brother. Oh, I hated that teacher. That teacher did this to me, and this, and I still carry that hatred. And you say you are born again. Being born again means you are free from all those sins. And then sometimes, look at this. It tells us in Galatians chapter 5, it tells us in verse 20 and verse 21. Galatians chapter 5, I'm reading to you from verse 20 and verse 21. It tells us, look at verse 20, it talks about idolatry, it talks about witchcraft, and then hatred. I'm not a witch, but you have hatred. I'm not a sorcerer, but you have hatred. I don't have powers of darkness, but you have hatred. Then the same group, then the same verse, they follow one another. It says idolatry. You don't worship idol, and witchcraft. You don't have witchcraft. I about hatred and variance and emulation and wrath. And wrath. It shows in your disposition. It shows in your breathing. It shows in everything that you do. It shows in the way you look. It shows, you know, if you are smiling and laughing with somebody now and you are very happy, and then this other person comes, all of a sudden, the appearance of that person will poison your conversation. It's like the moment you see him, the moment you see her, that kind of hatred will just come up like this. If it continues like that, you cannot get to heaven. Look at this in verse 21. Envying and murders and drunkenness and reveling and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. I pray things will change. I said, I pray things will change. You know, when we came to the church here for the first time, all we wanted was salvation. All we wanted was, I just want to repent. The word of God has been taught in that place. And I want to give myself to the word of God. It didn't matter to me, it didn't matter to you. What other people said, what other people did, how other people acted. All I wanted the word of God in that place, so that when the trumpet shall sound, I will get to heaven. But little by little by little, you dropped your interest in the Word of God. Yes, you still come for Bible study. That's why you are here today. And you still read the Bible. That's why you have the Bible in your hand there. But your interest in the Word of God has gone down. All you want now is to do this and do this and do that. And then the way we react to you and the way we talk to you and the way we interact with you. How could he talk to me like that? Doesn't he know now I am so and so very high there? Come down. Because if you remain in that pride and you bring in anger in your heart, every time you want everybody to be hovering around you and worshiping you and then prostrating and kneeling down, if that's in your heart, you might not get to heaven. And then those of us who will not, those of us like Mordecai, that will look at Haman and will say, no, we worship the Lord. We're not going to worship Haman. Then Haman is going to get angry. And Haman is going to say, who's this person? What does he think he is? That all the other people are worshiping me and he is not worshiping me. Well, we'll not worship you. Do whatever you will. But you must remember what happened to Haman. He went to hell prematurely. I pray you'll not go to hell. That all this hatred, all this animosity, everything will be cleansed today by the blood of the Lamb in Jesus' name. Give me a better amen. Hatred explained. Let me explain to you. Genesis chapter 27. Genesis chapter 27. It tells us in Genesis chapter 27, we're talking about a man. You've heard his name before. When I read it now, you'll understand. Genesis chapter 27, and we're reading from verse 41. Genesis 27, we're reading from verse 41. And Esau, that's the man, hated Jacob. And Esau hated Jacob. And Esau hated Jacob. This chapter 27, something had happened. Jacob did wrong. And Jacob thought, already you sold the birthright to me. This transaction is like commerce. I gave you something, trade by barter, and then you give me the birthright. And now my father is saying, come for the blessing of the bath. And I think, no, I'm the one that will take that because you already sold it to me. I paid for that. And so Jacob went and he got the birthright. And then Esau came later. And Esau saw that Jacob had got the birthright. He became angry. Why are you angry? You sold it. Why are you angry? You said you don't want it. Why are you angry? You threw it away. Why are you angry? In a moment of rashness, you said, take it. I don't want it. And now we are taking it because you said you don't want it. And now you are angry. And he said, Jacob hated Esau. Let me show you something. Because if you read what I'm going to read in Ezekiel, you'll not understand. If you don't understand Genesis chapter 36. Genesis chapter 36, I'm reading to you from verse 8 and verse 9. Genesis chapter 38, chapter 36, and we're reading from verse 8 and we're reading from verse 9. It says, then dwelt, thus dwelt Esau in Mount Seir. Esau is Edom. And these are the generations of Esau, the father of the Edomites in Mount Seir, the place of abode, the countryside, the country place of Esau and his descendants is referred to as Seir. Now come to Ezekiel, far, far away from Genesis. Ezekiel chapter 35. In Ezekiel chapter 35, we're reading here from verse 3. Ezekiel chapter 35, we're reading from verse 3. It says in verse 3, and say unto each, thus says the Lord God, behold, O Mount Seir. Remember, Mount Seir. Who does that belong to? Tell me out loud. Esau, thank you. I am against thee, and I will stretch out mine hand against thee, and I will make thee most desolate. I will lay thy cities waste, and thou shalt be desolate, and thou shalt know that I am the Lord. Look at this now, verse 5. It says, because thou hast had perpetual hatred and hast shed the blood of the children of Israel, by the force of the sword in the time that of their calamity, in the time that their iniquity had an end. You know what happened? Esau had hatred in Genesis against Jacob. And then as he was growing old, he still had that hatred. And then he sowed that hatred in the hearts of his own children and said, I hate Jacob. I hate his descendants. So if you belong to me, if you are my children, you must hate Jacob and hate the children of Israel. They said, yes, sir. They did. Those people, first generation, following after Esau, they told the grandchildren to Esau. They said, our father Esau hated Jacob, hated his children. You hear? We are passing that on to you. You must hate them. They said, yes, sir. That generation passed it on until this time of Ezekiel. Hundreds of years have passed. And yet, what Esau began, that hatred became perpetual. That, you know, he himself hated Jacob, and Jacob pleaded, and Jacob begged. He said, take all these things and go and give to my brother Esau. And then he said, go tell him, I'm coming with 400 people. And then he prayed all through the night, God, deliver me. Don't let this man come and destroy me and my family. And when they met, Jacob prostrated many times. And they hugged one another and they kissed one another. And Jacob wept. And Esau said, that's all right, it's all over. And but Jacob could tell, he saw it in his eyes. And when Esau said, let's move on, he said, no, all these people, they are young, you go. So that we don't overdrive them. And he went. And Esau still carried that hatred. Are you like that? And you pass that hatred to other people? You pass that animosity to other people? And the people that were not even born when those things happened, they didn't even know anything. Now, they are showing that same hatred, because you planted it in their heart. And these people, what did they know about what happened many years ago? That's what we're talking about. And the Lord is saying, you hinder these other people from getting to heaven because now they have the hatred. You tell your children, you must hate the children of those people. You tell your tribe, you must hate all those people. It's the hatred you are passing on. And when, look at that verse 5 again. Because that was perpetual hatred. Perpetual hatred. And that hatred also generated all the things. I pray that the Lord will deliver us in Jesus' name. So you come to the Lord and say, well, I want to get to heaven. All this hatred, animosity and bitterness and all that, I want to stop all that today so that the Lord will cleanse you. He'll save you, he'll restore you, and then he'll change your life and everything will come to an end in Jesus' name. But you know, the hatred of Esau meant nothing to Jacob. I've done my part. I've apologized to him. I tried to give him things, but he said he had enough. He'll not receive anything. And then I've settled with the Lord. And when you come to the Hebrews, Hebrews chapter 11, it says, by faith Moses, by faith Jacob, by faith this. They mentioned the name of Jacob by faith. They never mentioned the name of Esau. Jacob is now in heaven. Esau, all that hatred did not matter, did not do anything to Jacob at all. You are the loser. Because now Esau is in hell. How can we say that? Hebrews chapter 12. I'm reading from Hebrews chapter 12. And we're looking at verse 15. Hebrews chapter 12 verse 15. It says, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God. Lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you. And thereby many be defiled. Many children of Esau defiled by that hatred. And many generations following after Esau defiled because of that hatred. Lest there be any fornicator or profane person as Esau, who sold, who for one morsel of meat sold his birthright. For ye know how that afterwards, when he would have received the blessing, it was rejected because he found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully with tears. He sought it with tears, but it was gone. I pray for us, our time will not go in Jesus' name. You see, somebody has written this, you know, he's talking about the Lord himself. He said, you call me Savior and believe me not. You call me Master and obey me not. You call me Shepherd and follow me not. You call me Lord and serve me not. You call me Eternal and seek me not. You call me Judge and fear me not. You call me King and honor me not. You call me Love and desire me not. You call me Might and trust me not. If I condemn you, blame me not. Because he's provided all the salvation. He's provided forgiveness. And you say, Lord, Lord, Shepherd, is my Savior. Is this, and yet you do not repent from your sin. He says, you call me everything, and yet you'll not repent. If I condemn you on the final day, blame me not. I pray you will not be condemned. Because this is the chance for you to say, Lord, all this one I forsake. All these sins, I turn away from them. I want Jesus Christ to be my Lord and my Savior. And I will not remain in all these evil things. Let's come to point number three now. And this is essential precept for saints in Christ. We're looking at 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 7. 1 John chapter 2, verse 7. It says, brethren, I write no new commandment unto you, but an old commandment which ye heard from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which ye have heard from the beginning. Again, a new commandment I write unto you, which thing is true in him and in you, because that darkness, the darkness is past, and the true light now shineth. It's talking about a new commandment. He said, to start with, I write no new commandment unto you. Why did he say that? Oh, he said, from the very beginning, all this commandment of loving one another has been there. To love God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind, that commandment has been there. Come to Deuteronomy chapter 30, and I'm reading here from verse 6. Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 6. So that you will see that the commandment to love God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind has always been there. Because God is love. From the before the beginning of the world, that's the attributes of God. Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 6. And it says, the Lord thy God will circumcise thine heart and the heart of thy seed to love the Lord thy God with all thine heart and with all thy soul, that thou mayest live. He said, that's the commandment of the Lord. That's why it circumcises the heart, sanctifies the heart. That's why it takes away the Adamic nature. That's why it takes away that inbred sin. That's why it takes away that depravity, so that you can love the Lord with all your heart without any reservation. It was already there in the Old Testament. Look at Leviticus. I'm reading from verse 19. Leviticus chapter 19. And we're reading from verse 18. Leviticus chapter 19. And we're reading from verse 18. To love your neighbor. In verse 18, this is what it says. Thou shalt not avenge nor bear any grudge. Huh. Thou shalt not avenge nor bear any grudge. Nor bear any grudge. That's where bitterness starts, bearing grudge. That's where hatred begins, bearing grudge. That's where fighting begins, bearing grudge. He did something, maybe he didn't even know that he did anything. And because he did something that you judge wrong, you judge negative, and the fellow is just having a nice time, doesn't even know he did anything wrong, and you're bearing grudge because of that, bitterness will come, hatred will come, you'll be on your way to hell. But it says in verse 18, thou shalt not avenge nor bear any grudge against the children of thy people, but thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. I am the Lord. That's why John the beloved said, I'm writing to you concerning love. It's not a new thing. Come back to 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. And now we read in verse 8. It says again, a new commandment I write unto you, which thing is true in him and in you, because that the darkness is past and the true light now shineth. He said, well, it's a new commandment. It's not a new commandment, because it had been written in the Bible, Deuteronomy, Leviticus, all the Old Testament, that love was there. But it is new because the darkness and the veil of the old covenant is over. The hardness of heart in the old covenant is over. Christ has now come, and Christ has come to demonstrate unto us what love is and how to love. He loved his disciples, you saw that. He loved God, you saw that. He loved the sinners, you saw that. He sacrificed himself and demonstrated perfect love. He said, because darkness is past, because the veil is gone from our eyes, and because the confusion is gone, it's a new commandment. And that's why Jesus said in John chapter 13, reading from verse 34. John chapter 13, we're looking at it from verse 34. Here it tells us, 13:34 of the gospel according to St. John. It says in verse 34, a new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another. Here's the new part of it now, as I have loved you. It's no more like the Old Testament. You love them as you love yourself. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. It says, now I've demonstrated love for you, and I'm showing you that I love you more than myself. I carried your sin, I carried your shame, I carried your sorrow. I made myself poor that you might be rich. I came and suffered so that you will not suffer. I carried eternal punishment for you so that you will not be punished. I've shown you that I didn't just love you as I love myself. I love you more than myself. It says, now this new commandment I give unto you. The old is gone. The darkness is gone. Love one another as I have loved you. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one to another. And then he tells us in 1 John chapter 2. I'm reading here from verse 10. Look at 1 John chapter 2 verse 10. He tells us in verse 10, he that loveth his brother abideth in the light. He that loveth his brother abideth in the light. What's the opposite of that? He that hateth his brother abideth in darkness. You hate your wife, you abide in darkness. And that's why you should not take a decision when you have hatred, when you have bitterness, because you are in darkness. You can't see your way. You don't know where you are going. You know, you're angry, you want to take a decision, you are bitter, you want to take a decision, and you are frustrated, you want to take a decision. An angry man is living in darkness. You don't have the light to be able to take the right decision when you're in the dark. But when love has come, when all that darkness is gone, when the bitterness is gone, it says, he that loveth his brother abideth in the light, and there is none occasion of stumbling in him. You'll not throw something in front of somebody to make him stumble when you have love. You'll not do something to make a person provoked and then fall and lose his step and miss his way and lose his consecration, commitment to the Lord. If you love him, it says, if you love, there'll be no stumbling block you're going to put in the face of anyone. The Lord is talking to us that today we must come back to Calvary. We'll go back to Calvary. Am I talking to somebody there? I said, we'll go back to Calvary. And then we're going to have the mark of loyalty. The mark of loyalty. What's the mark of loyalty? Because he's my master. Because he's my Lord. The mark in my life is I want to follow him in everything. And also we're going to have the model of lifestyle. What's the model of lifestyle? The Lord Jesus Christ himself. Because he that says he abideth in him must walk even as he walked. We're going to have that model of lifestyle. And then the manifestation of his love. Manifestation of his love. Because we believe him. And because he lives in us. The Christ who lives in us does not have hatred, does not have bitterness. And because he lives in us and through us, he wants to manifest that love. Number one, you experience redemption through his love. Experience redemption through his love. He died for you on the cross of Calvary. And you come to Calvary now, you say, I want to experience redemption through his love. Number two, you enter into relationship, the relationship of his love. Because you see, this love we're talking about is a relationship. He redeemed you because he loved you. And then you enter into this relationship, a relationship of love. And therefore, you love him and you love all the people that belong to him. And every time you see anyone belonging to Christ, because I love Christ, I love the person belonging to Christ, I enter into relationship of his love. You embrace the responsibility of his love. You see, responsibility, love will do something. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him would not perish but have everlasting life. And you say, this is love. Somebody is sick, what's the responsibility? Take care of him. Somebody is naked, what's the responsibility? You clothe him. Somebody is hungry, what's the responsibility of love? You give him food. You enter, embrace the responsibility of his love. You exercise the restraint of his love. The restraint of his love. Your love will restrain us. If you love somebody, there are things you will never do. Love will restrain you. If you love somebody, there are things you'll never say. Because, you know, if I say that, it will hurt her. If I say that, it will hurt him. There are things you'll never plan. If I plan that and carry out that plan, it will destroy that man. It will destroy that woman. There is a restraint of love. Love will restrain you. It will restrain your action. It will restrain your behavior. It will restrain your attitude. You have the redemption through his love. And you have the relationship of his love. You have the responsibility of his love. You have the restraint of his love. You establish the reconciliation because of his love. Reconciliation because of his love. If there's somebody that, you know, he goes this way, you go that way. Now you understand, that's hatred. That's animosity. That's bitterness. Why is it you don't want to see his face? Why is it you don't want to look at him face to face? Why is it you're afraid of his face? Afraid of his smile? Afraid of interaction with him? And then he's coming this way, you are going the other way. When this love gets into you today, thank God is coming to you today. Are you there? I said, thank God love is coming to you today. It will bring you to the establishment of reconciliation because of his love. And then there's the remembrance of his love. Do this in remembrance of me. Every time you take this bread, every time you drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death that he died for you until he comes and is coming again. The remembrance of his love at the Lord's Supper. You will not be avoiding the Lord's Supper, running away from the Lord's Supper. You're always being disqualified from the Lord's Supper. You don't love the Lord and you don't remember what he has done for you. You're looking for, when are we going to take the Lord's Supper? I want the remembrance of his love. His love for me, that he died for me on the cross of Calvary. I want to remember that. You want to ensure the remembrance of his love. You want to exemplify renewal in his love. Renewal in his love. You wake up in the morning, Lord, give me back the first love. Lord, give me back the fresh love. Lord, give me back the fervent love. And if you're a real child of, I want to love him more. I want to look at what he did for me, and look at what he gave up for me, and look at all the lengths he went for me, the first love and the fresh love and the fervent love. I want to renew that love every day. That's what the Lord is calling us to. And he says, if you love God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and you love your fellow brother, your fellow sister, just like I have loved you, you have fulfilled the whole law. If you love, you're not going to steal. If you love, you're not going to commit adultery with another man's wife. If you love, you're not going to tell a lie. If you love, you're not going to condemn another person. If you love, you're not going to kill another person. If you love, you're not going to bear false witness. Love is the fulfillment of the totality of the word of God, because it's a summary of the prophets and the law. And the Lord is calling us today to come back to Calvary. There is love flowing from Calvary. It will flow into your heart. It will flow into your soul, and your life and everything around will change. Your personality will change. Your family will change. Your life will change. Your conduct will change. And then you will know for sure, I am born again, because he that loveth is in the light and he has eternal life. He that hateth does not have eternal life abiding in him. You know that is a murderer, and a murderer does not have eternal life abiding in them. We can come back to Calvary today, and the Lord, he will forgive, he will cleanse, he will change, he'll put away our feet in the path of love, of righteousness again. It will happen. Somebody there said it will happen. We're going to rise up and we're going to pray. You call on the Lord and say, Lord, I need this. I need this. I need this. Renew my love for you. Renew my love for my brethren. Renew my love for your word. Renew my love for your worship. I don't want any form of hatred, any form of bitterness, anything that is not of you, Lord. I reject everything. I just want you to be the crown of my life and the joy of my Christian experience. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord in prayer.